TB. Have you ever walked into a church that was empty? I'm sure you have. There's that silence that's somehow the sound of its own. Imagine that sound, but instead of carpet and hymnals, picture metal beds and spider webs. It's okay for you to still picture the pulpit there because it's actually still there, all lonely in the front. Then imagine that your breathing is a little shallow because you keep thinking about the tuberculosis that lives in the sanctuary. Breathing seems risky, so you subconsciously keep from doing it. Despite the ghetto environment, this place has a mystical, recuperative atmosphere that's linked to the community of those who are living under the same roof in what seems to be one big, drafty dorm room. Tall, skinny church windows climb the walls every 5 feet, and about 20 metal beds, some with and some without mattresses, randomly occupy the floor. The old church is being used as the tuberculosis ward. The people who are diagnosed at the hospital are given free treatment through a program called DOT, Directly Observed Treatment. This means that someone will watch them take their pills each morning to ensure that they get better, because if you don't treat TB consistently for a full 3 months, it won't ever go away. So these people have this experience, which we hope is a once-in-a-lifetime thing, of living together under a church roof while ridding their bodies of TB. I used some of the money that one of my good friends sent to buy paint. Now the next 2 weeks will be a painting marathon. We'll be painting big murals in whatever colors we can mix and make. The hospital is turning what is now the TB ward into a pediatrics ward, and the TB patients will be moved into some newly constructed mud brick rooms, perhaps two to a room instead of communal living style. With these changes, we'll do a better job of confining the germs, and the new pediatrics ward will triple the size of the current one, allowing us to care for more babies. When I walked into the TB ward this afternoon, it was almost empty. Only one person was still in there, a man who was sitting on his bed. He was attached to an IV, probably being treated for malaria on top of the TB, and couldn't go outside into the sun like the rest of the patients tend to do during the day. He just sat with his legs hanging down off the edge of the bed. I had to do a double take because I couldn't tell whether there were legs in his pants. He was just so skinny. The rapid loss of weight is one of the symptoms of TB. I said, "La piega," which means something like, "How well is it going?" He slowly reached up, took my hand, and said in almost a whisper, "Lapia," which means something like, "Well." Then he turned the question around, asking me, "Lapiaiga?" I said, "Ongilia dindi, I'm a little bit tired." Without missing a beat, he said in the same whisper, "Kumuma bama," God will give it. I agreed, but then thought about his situation and wondered what God has given him. But he hadn't told me what God would give, just that he would give it. I think I'm going to paint that on the wall somewhere. God will give it. Then people will ask, "What is it?" And no one will have the answer because our hope rests in the fact that God is big and complex and beyond us. And that's what we want him to be, isn't it? Will he give me rest? Maybe not. Health? Maybe not. Sickness may continue, but hope will also continue. And the loss of hope seems to be a much heavier thing to bear than sickness is. I'm tired, but kumama bama.